Welcome to another edition of Pittsburgh Sportsline live in the BP TV studios. Thanks for watching our show. We appreciate you. Smoke and Jim got caught up into some traffic. Chip just hung up with him because can't talk anymore. We got a show to do, but it doesn't look like Smoke and Jim's going to make it on time. There was some accident on Parkway East. Liberty Tunnel, Liberty Bridge had a problem today, so that's the update with Smoke and Jim. We'll just play it by ear. He may walk in and he may not, but we'll see what happens. I'm Al Levine, the talking machine. I got Chip Hayner with me. We got a lot of great sports to talk about today. We'll extend some of our conversation when we can. We'll eat up the time. Somehow we manage to do it.
Plenty to talk about.
Well, we'll get it done. We got Tessa in the control room. Thanks for setting it up. Man, we look good on the screen. This is live TV, so thank you very much. We just hit a new high on Facebook for our page, 6,414. So appreciate a couple more likes. Appreciate that. Watch us on Verizon 32 everywhere in the Pittsburgh area. Wait, Smoking Jim may be trying to text me there. No, that wasn't him. That's somebody else. Got a little action going on here, but we'll see what happens. And check us out, Comcast 7, only in Bethel Park. We appreciate all the Bethel Park residents watching us. And we're going to start our show with What's On Your Mind. Oh, there's no Smoking Jim Frazier, so I'm going to go right to Chip Hayner. What's on? Well, first, hey, I just got to at least thank Olive Oil's Pizzeria, our sponsor of our show tonight, right at, got us the pizza and steak hoagie. We appreciate it. 412-831-1900. Give them a call. Sarah's on the phone. They're waiting for you. Give them a call. Order up their pizza. It's great stuff. So we're going to start with Chip Hayner. And what's on your mind?
Well, being that, good evening, everybody. So I'm glad to be back this week. Little work-related issues last week. Unable to make it in. But
he's back.
Yeah, back in the saddle again. Hallelujah. Baseball season has started. The Pirates, they started a little slow out of the gate yesterday, but it's going to be a great baseball season. I am very excited for what the Pirates are going to do this year. But we'll talk more about them later.
Yes, we will.
So what's on my mind? You know, I think about a number of different things, and I'm going to touch on two of them because my dear friend Jim Frazier's seat is absent this week. But what's on my mind is the NHL. Now, the commissioner of the NHL, Gary Bettman, who, if anybody knows over the years that I've been critical of Gary Bettman, I've been critical of the commissioner of baseball. I've been, you know, critical of the commissioner of the NFL. That's a
Chip,
long
story. Chip, it's the first time you admitted to this.
Yeah, but Gary Bettman, I don't think has his head screwed on completely straight. Now, here's what the latest announcement from the NHL was. Now, part of this I agree with, and part of it I think is part of the problem as to why the NHL has a problem getting out their brand and creating more interest in the sport.
Okay.
So, you know, Gary Bettman announced that in the upcoming Olympics in Seoul, South Korea, the Winter Olympics, that the NHL would not be sending over any of their players to play in the hockey tournament in the Olympics. Now, standing by itself, I personally think that once they started letting professional athletes play in the Olympics, it kind of detracted from the Olympics, and I always liked the true amateur nature of the Olympics. That's what made the Miracle on Ice such a miracle, was the fact that a bunch of United States college kids got together and formed, you know, and under the guidance of Herb Brooks, and beat the Russians and won the gold medal in 1980.
Wow.
One of the greatest events in sporting history. And the thing that made it so great was the fact that it was a bunch of amateurs that went up against the Russian team.
Professional.
And, you know, So, I think it's a joke that American basketball players, the best in the world, go to the Olympics and destroy the rest of the world to win a gold medal. I mean, they don't even have to have the tournament. Just go ahead and award them the medals. But here's what happens is they shut down the NHL for 3 weeks in the middle of the season. And when they do this is in the month of February, which is one of the few times that the NHL could be the focal point of people's attention. Football season's over. Spring training's going on, which doesn't garner a lot of interest. Right. So you're not into the regular season of the Major League Baseball. You're in the midst of the season of the NBA. So I understand the NHL not wanting its best players playing in the Olympics and their sports shut down when the owners aren't making any revenue, the league's not making any revenue, because they get nothing for allowing their players to play in the Olympics. So they said that, no, we're not going to play in the next Olympics, and it's in Seoul, South Korea. But they would consider playing in the next Olympics after that, which happens to be in China. Now, the hypocritical nature of this is you don't want to have the NHL players playing in a country that probably doesn't have the population of the state of California. But when you go over to China and how many billions of people there, and they think, wow, we could look at all the look at all the marketing possibilities. So then they change their tune. It has to be one way or the other. Either, you want to put the teams out there internationally and market your brand, or you don't. You can't have it both ways. And I think that Gary Bettman is doing a disservice to the NHL. And he's, more importantly, he's doing it to the Olympic movement. Personally, myself, I don't like to see the professional players in the Olympics. But all of that aside, if you're going to do it based on a matter of convenience,
he's being selective.
It's horrible. And then once again, they're giving the NHL another black eye, and they're flattening the tires on the bus. And it's never going to get rolling. It's never going to get the exposure worldwide that you would want it to have. That's the first thing that's on my mind that I'm just...
I'm glad you got that out.
The second one is on Sunday, the PGA, the LPGA took a championship away from a young woman golfer because of an infraction that happened on Saturday that somebody emailed the LPGA on Sunday morning to tell them about that. So that halfway through the round on Sunday, the golfer Lexi Thompson was hit with a 4-stroke penalty. At the time, she was 2 strokes in the lead of the tournament. She took a 4-stroke penalty for incorrectly replacing her ball after she marked it on the green, and B, for signing an incorrect scorecard, which at the time that she signed it, she had no idea that it was incorrect. It wasn't until much after the fact that it was determined. She had the wherewithal to ultimately end up tying for the tournament and lost in a playoff. Okay? Wow. Now, this is what my point is. If you see an infraction, and there are rules, people, for the PGA sure. Tour, on every hole, and they're watching everything. They're making judgments based on various things. And nobody saw anything wrong with that at the time. Okay? So the woman finishes her round and signs her card under the impression that everything was done above the board. Where do we draw the line at where you can point out an infraction and give somebody a penalty?
Sure.
You give it to her halfway through the round and the next day. You think about it. Look at the basketball game last night. The kid was out of bounds. There's video evidence he was out of bounds.
50-some seconds left in the game.
So what do we do? Fly back? All those people go back to Phoenix, put 50 seconds on the clock, and replay the end of the game? It's ridiculous. And I think that the LPGA was pretty poor way to handle the situation. If, in fact, she had misplaced the ball, they should have given her a two-stroke penalty.
Right, at that time.
And the signing the incorrect scorecard, she would have never signed the scorecard if she had known that it was incorrect. So, you're punishing her after the fact for something that the rules people said it was okay. So I don't know what's happening to sports, but you asked me what's on my mind. These are a couple of head scratchers that I've got for this week.
Wow. They're two powerful ones, Chip. I got to digest that. My daughter texted me. She's at the has great seats at the Penguin game tonight. So
good for her.
Penguins against Columbus. She got great seats. So way to go, Casey. I just like to show some of the brochures that I have. The Joey Fabus Childhood Cancer Foundation. We end each show with Stay Joey Strong. Poor kid never made it. Joey never made it to his ninth birthday. There he is. You can see him with DIPG, the brain cancer. And to segue, they have an event coming up May 12th, Night at the Races. I don't know if you can see that. May 12th. And that's at the Bethel Park Community Center. Doors open at 7. Race start at 7:30. About 10 races with 10 horses in each. Cost you $10 to buy a horse, name a horse, and you can win $40 in each race. So they got plans for that. Raise some money to get it to try to fight DIPG. So check that out. The Bethel Park Historical Schoolhouse Arts and History Center on South Park Road. Donate a dollar there. It's a great community center. They got a library there. They got businesses that rent. So check it out. A lot of great things happening there. The Bethel Park Community Foundation, where I'm a trustee, has money, but they also gave a grant to the Historical Society for, I think it's 10 windows. So they're going to have 10 new windows because they're standardizing all the windows in the building. So you'll see that gradually over the summer and next coming months. So check it out. But they have from $100 to $5,000 for people in Bethel Park that have their group organization helping the kids and people in the community. So that's bpcf.org. Grab an application there and check it out. And last but not least, Dave Cable made a nice little poster with Uncle Al on it. I don't know if you can pull up on it, but I want you for a BP TV volunteer. He grabbed my face and morphed it on there, and that way the one people behind the cameras, you can come here and run the cameras here, like Tessa's in the control room.
So instead of calling you Uncle Sam, we'll call you Uncle Al?
Yeah, call me Uncle Al. We got it. Look at that outfit. There's even a video on it. We had some fun with it. That face looks pretty good in there. Thank you. Boy, I did so many things, I forget what's on my mind. Let me think about it. First of all, nice shirt, Chip. Watch the Bucco game. What's on my mind? I watched the Bucks. Garrett Cole was unbelievable the first 4 2/3 innings. Then after that, ended up giving up 5 runs. And that was one bad inning. And the Pirates come back with 3 runs. Ended up losing the game 5-3. But what impressed me was the bullpen. 3 scoreless innings in the bullpen. I think they had 5 strikeouts out of the 9 that they could have had. So they performed rather well. Gives me some hope that the Pirate pitching will be all right. One bad inning from Cole. I know he's a competitor, loves to win, and that sucks. But you are talking, Boston does have a pretty good lineup.
Well,
and they got some hitters and players, and their rookie through.
They say that may be the best lineup in the American League. But that's, hey, there's another game tomorrow, man.
Wednesday night, they'll have a game, so I'm all in on the Bucco bandwagon.
Oh, yeah.
Let's go, Bucks. It's early in the season. I need a shirt just like Chipper. Look at that. Mm-hmm. Let's go, Buccos. But that's what's on my mind. We're going to go take a little break. Don't change that dial. Chief, enjoy your dessert. I know you're about ready to dig in. That'd be great. I did see our man, Bobby Beers, today. So I got to talk to my man. And just a great thing there. And we're going to go to this commercial and we'll come back with Chip and his trivia.
Ooh. Yeah, the
I've shown an interest in making home movies. Me and some buddies would just grab a camera and just start making these videos, and then you realize at some point that this isn't just a hobby anymore, it's something that you actually want to pursue, and there's this great facility right down the road BPTV. A lot of people will try to do these productions on their own, and one of the things they don't have is the equipment, you know. But right here is everything that she needs in one nice little bundle. There's lights, cameras, reflectors, dollies, all kinds of little knickknacks. Like anything that you'd want to use that she would need for a production, you have it right here. Like, it's all right here. You can make your own feature movie just with the stuff from this studio. Come meet Dave Cable, let him show you around, and I think you'll realize that this is something that you could fall into regardless of your level of expertise, whether you're a beginner or even if you're a more advanced learner. There's something here for everyone, and I feel that you just need to come through and just be a part of the experience and just watch and learn, and you know, let Dave be your guide.
One of the things we do at BPTV is encourage our producers to film on location. Not only does shooting on location give our producers the opportunity to take advantage of their subject matter, filming in different locations gives each program its own distinct flavor. This also helps anyone who's flipping through the channels avoid confusion when they turn on BPTV. With around 500 programs produced at BPTV each year, the last thing we want people to think is that we're only broadcasting one program. So, you need to come into BPTV to pitch your TV show, but in terms of where you actually end up taping your show, the sky's the limit.
All right, we got Chip. Get Chip on the camera here for
Chip's trivia time. And, you know, we will touch on what went on Sunday night, actually Friday night, Saturday, Sunday night, Monday, with the NCAA basketball championships. But just to kind of touch on some things, some facts about the NCAA basketball tournament. You know, you've got the schools with the most Final Four appearances.
Whoa.
And it's led by none other than this year's champion, the North Carolina Tar Heels, with 19, followed by UCLA, who also holds the most men's championships with 11, Kentucky with 17,
wow,
and 8 championships, that followed by Duke with 16 Final Four appearances and 5 championships. Kansas with 14 appearances and 3 championships, Ohio State with 1, and that does have some significance, and I'll talk to you about that one later, with 11 Final Four appearances, and then Louisville with 10 Final Four appearances and 3 championships. But
nice.
Some interesting facts I found out about the NCAA men's basketball tournaments.
Come on.
35 different teams have won the NCAA tournament, but UCLA leads all schools with 11 titles. The first NCAA men's basketball tournament was held in 1939 and consisted of only 8 teams. The University of Oregon won the very first NCAA tournament in 1939. They made it to the Final Four this year. In 1997, the NCAA made it a requirement that the Final Four must be held in a dome stadium with a seating capacity of at least 40,000.
Really?
In 2009, the capacity minimum was raised to 70,000. The NCAA wants to make sure they get their dollar. Only once in tournament history have all 4 number one seeds advanced to the Final Four, when Kansas, North Carolina, UCLA, and Memphis met in 2008.
Yeah.
Was that one of the years that Calipari had to forfeit all their wins? I don't know, but he hasn't gone fit for any violations yet in Kentucky.
No.
The lowest seed to ever win the NCAA tournament, Villanova, as a number 8 seed in 1985.
Wow.
Elite
last year's champs.
Yes, it was. And I do remember the team in 85 with Raleigh Massimino as the head coach. Yeah. Back when the Big East was the conference with coaches like John Thompson, Jim Calhoun, Jim Boeheim. There was Lou Carnesecca at St. John's. And John Thompson at...
you're bringing on trivia and trivia. You know,
at Georgetown. UCLA coach John Wooden has the most national championships with 10. Among active coaches, Duke's Mike Krzyzewski leads the way with 4 titles. UConn's women's basketball coach, Gino Auriemma, has won 11. Everything is bigger in Texas. AT&T Stadium, home of the 2014 Final Four, with a capacity of 80,000, is the largest stadium to ever host a Final Four. And the Connecticut Huskies are the only school to win his and her national championships in the same year. The women's team won theirs one day after the men in 2004 and again in 2014.
Wow.
It's been done twice. Now, there was the potential for this to have happened again this year. The South Carolina women's won the NCAA tournament. And the men's team did make it to the Final Four before they bowed out to Gonzaga.
Yeah.
So it's happened twice, but both times it was University of Connecticut. Pretty pretty amazing stuff.
Yeah, it is.
Kansas City, Missouri has hosted the most Final Fours to date with 10 since 1953. Indianapolis can overtake that mark in 2035. And the reason why
did
this is...
Did you say 2035?
Yes, I did. And this is just shows you how ridiculous the NCAA is. It is now an official NCAA rule that the Final Four take place in Indianapolis. Oh, by the way, where the NCAA's headquarters are, every 5 years. The city has hosted 6 times already.
Whoa. Now I see where you got it. I didn't know that.
3 individuals have won the NCAA championship as a player and as a coach. Joe B. Hall as a player and a coach of Kentucky. Bobby Knight as a player with Ohio State.
Wow.
Their only national champion, and as a coach of the University of Indiana.
I didn't know that.
And Dean Smith as a player at Kansas and the head coach at North Carolina.
What a legend.
Yeah, there you go. The NIT tournament used to take precedence over the NCAA tournament until the 70s, when the NCAA barred teams from playing in other postseason tournaments if they declined an invitation to March Madness. In 2005, the NCAA purchased the NIT. And remember what was the name of the university? Was it Bradley? That won the NIT and the NCAA both in the same year.
Yeah.
That is why that will never happen again. And it's just greed, that's all.
Follow the money.
Never once in the NCAA tournament has a number 16 seed beaten a number 1 seed. It's going to happen one day, folks. Will it be in my lifetime? We'll see. The record for the most points scored by an individual in the NCAA tournament belongs to Austin Carr, who recorded 61 points in Notre Dame's 1970 opener. Loyola Marymount scored the most amount of points by a team in one game with 149 in 1990, while North Carolina holds the record for fewest points after recording 20 in a 1941 game.
Whoa. That's a shocker.
So, you know, that would be a great trivia question. You could probably win a few drinks on that one at the bar. Fewest number of points scored in the NCAA tournament game, nobody would guess it was North Carolina.
20 points.
The record for most overtimes in a single game is 4. It happened twice, once in 1956 and again in 1961.
Wow.
Glenn Rice holds the record for most points in a single tournament with 184 during Michigan's 1989 run. And Duke's Christian Laettner holds the career record with 407 points in 23 games in his career.
Wow.
The Tennessee Lady Vols have been to the Big Dance every year since the women's tournament was introduced in 1982.
What a record.
There you go. The odds of filling out a perfect bracket are 1 in 9 and put 18 zeros after that.
What is that number?
That's a quintillion. All right.
Wow. One in one quintillion. I can't even imagine that.
That's pretty amazing.
No wonder they put up this Warren Buffett and the rest of them say, here, win a bracket, you get $1 million.
Because you know what? That money's safe in the bank, and it's not going anywhere.
It's some insurance policy they got.
Okay, so. Now getting down to the final two here. The oldest coach to win a title was Jim Calhoun in 2001 at the age of 68. The title of the youngest coach belongs to none other than Emmett McCracken, who led Indiana to the championship in 1940 at the age of 31.
Wow.
Anybody around that remembers that?
I'm sure we got a few watching that know that.
Okay, and then last but not least, it has been a long tradition that NCAA tournament champions have cut down the nets to take home. But since 1986, the winning school has also been given the hardwood court too. Many
really?
Sell and or auction off pieces to fans.
Really?
That's I knew they chopped down the nets. I did not know.
They chopped up the floor.
They chopped up the floor. Wow. So there are some interesting facts.
Great trivia.
Regarding the NCAA basketball tournament. Champions were crowned last night and Sunday night. And who knows? North Carolina is the champion for now. We'll
it
see
took
what,
them 365 days to overcome that loss from last year.
We'll see how long it takes them to lose that title. Once the academic improprieties are fully investigated and punishments are handed down. So they may lose more than one national championship for that.
Jeez.
Because, you know, we'll see where the investigation leads because I don't believe that's fake news.
That might be well known. Oh, thanks, Chip. And we will see what happens to their win if they get to keep it. So, but it was an interesting game. I watched it last night. Refereeing, my dad's rolling over in his grave. You shouldn't notice the zebras.
Yeah, that's one thing that you've said. You said that your dad was attributed to telling you that more than once. That, you know, if you watch the game and you never noticed the referees, then they were doing their job. And apparently, they wanted to get some TV time last night. They called 27 fouls in the second half. And even though I slept through the second half, I understand it was one of the worst played halves of championship basketball in recent
There was no momentum scoring-wise or whatever on who was bringing the ball up. Many stoppages.
And I understand that because there's so many stoppages, nobody could get in a rhythm. The shooting percentages were atrocious.
They were terrible, no doubt about it. So.
But, you know, that wraps up another, you know, the NCAA basketball tournament, I think, from the beginning of March Madness all the way down to the championship, it truly is amazing because, you know, most of the players that you see, you know, a handful of them are going to go on to NBA greatness. Most of them will make more money in their professional careers not playing basketball. And you just really see, you know, kids playing their hearts out, you know, because it's their one, and for a lot of cases, it's the last chance they have to put it out for them.
And North Carolina had an older team with juniors and seniors on it, so it shows a little different.
It looked like they had
more,
I tell you what, it looked like they were more like grown men instead of children, but I don't know.
It was a little different from the theory of the one and done, you know, coming into the league and playing your freshman year, so maybe he has something.
John Calipari seems to be able to get his team deep in a tournament every year, and he seems to work that system well. I'm not a big fan of it. You know, I remember back in the late 60s, early 70s, back when John Wooden was winning all his championships, that freshmen...
He developed the players.
Yeah, freshmen were not allowed to play. You know, they were only allowed to play their sophomore, junior, and senior season. That's why Kareem Abdul, or Lew Alcindor, only won 3 MVP awards.
Sure.
Because...
He was limited.
Because he only got to play for 3 seasons, you know? So, same thing with Bill Walton. But
sure. And it's changed. It's a different sport.
If it would have been nowadays, they would have played 1 year. They would have gone on to the NBA millions. Yes.
Well, thanks, Chip. And I had a little discussion with your points. Appreciate it. On location, we were at Hollywood Lanes. Congratulations to Jeffrey Park and Lindsay Marie, the proud mother of a new baby, Danielle Juliet. She was actually at the show because Lindsay Marie's the manager. She goes, I got to see the Al Levine, the Talking Machine show. So she did see it. So thank you to you guys. appreciate everybody that came out. We had the Wildcats with the Z at the end, Western Pennsylvania Wildcats. They were undefeated, 14-0. They won in Daytona Beach. They're national champions of their division. They come out in full force, had about 12 players there, so we had some fun. Shout out to Darren Dolby, boxing manager and coach of Gerald Sherrill, G5. Great guest on the show. He's 6-0 as a professional. Had a nice fight the other night at the Carnegie Music Hall. Smoke and Jim and I were guests there, and it's really a nice facility up there. It was right up on the stage where they do all these different shows. And the ironic thing is the stage is sloped by about 9 inches. So they had to adjust it all the way back to level at the boxing ring. And John Flanagan, it was his ring. So I got the insights because we know John. And he was telling us about that. So, and thanks again to Mike McSorley. He had Ukrainian boxers that had over 200 plus fights. Both of them won their fights. And it was a great night of fights that night, so I appreciate that. And just great to have people there. And it was a nice show last night at the Hollywood Lanes. And thanks to Frank Favis for all the photos. We even interviewed him for about the night at the races that's coming up May 12th that I talked about. And that's for the Joey Favis Childhood Cancer Foundation, to donate money there to help get DIPG. So we're going to go to a commercial now. And stay tuned on that dial, get a dessert, go to the bathroom, and come back if you're on Comcast 7 or Verizon 32. We're going to be talking some Penguins. Walking up, we were down around the first row. He was up on the stage.
Okay.
And I just missed him, so I didn't get a chance to say hi to him. So.
I wonder if he bury the hatchet.
No, I did talk to him once before, and then he was bad mouthing me after that. So,
hey, here's.
Hello. Are we still live? Whoa, we're still live.
Yeah.
Are we going to that commercial?
Oops.
Visit the Oliver Miller Homestead, an 18th century reenactment site located just off the circle on Corrigan Drive in South Park. Self-guided tours are available each Sunday from May 1st until December 8th from 1:30 until 4:30 p.m. with guides in 18th century garb located around the grounds to answer questions and to give information. Your tour will begin in a reproduction bank barn where displays give information on the movement west. You will also see the Miller Still and learn about the production of whiskey and the importance of it and of the whiskey rebellion to this area. Follow the Miller Trail up the path and visit the transportation shed, demonstration shed, forge, a reproduction log house, the original spring house, gardens, and finally end at the stone house. Each month, the guides host at least one special event. The homestead is also a great place for tours, tailored to the needs of school-age children, scout groups, or adults. Visit our website at www.olivermillerhomestead.org for a schedule for the year and much more information on the history of the Miller family, our organization, and pricing information.
One of the things we do at BPTV is encourage our producers to film on location. Not only does shooting on location give our producers the opportunity to take advantage of their subject matter, filming in different locations gives each program its own distinct flavor. This also helps anyone who's flipping through the channels avoid confusion when they turn on BPTV. With around 500 programs produced at BPTV each year, the last thing we want people to think is that we're only broadcasting one program. So, you need to come into BPTV to pitch your TV show. But in terms of where you actually end up taping your show, the sky's the limit.
Welcome back, folks. Sorry for that little problem there. We got some thing with the features here. My mistake. You caught us there talking. That's what we do in between on the commercials. Hope you enjoyed the commercial.
Little fly in the ointment.
Yeah, yeah. We're back with the Penguins are playing tonight. Yes, they're sir. 1 point behind Columbus. And it could be a preview of the playoff, the second and third team. And the playoffs are going to play each other. And it looks like this is the matchup. So I hope my daughter's enjoying the game. Devin Shea's at the game. I heard he got tickets for it. He's down low. So I know Casey got great seats down low also. So enjoy it from Bethel Park. And we're here to talk about it.
Yeah, so here's what the deal is. You know, the Penguins and the Blue Jackets each have 4 games left in the regular season. The Penguins have a 1-point lead over Columbus. And, you know, they can really put themselves in the driver's seat. But I really think that, you know, they're going to end up 2-3. Now, what's the difference between ending up in second place or third place? They end up in second place. They get home ice advantage. Yeah. So, which would mean if it went to a game 7, they would play game 7 here. If Columbus ends up in second place, so, you know, it would be well within the Penguins' best interest.
They need everybody healthy.
To win.
Kunitz is hurt now. And
his
career could be done.
Yep, and we've got no score in the first period down at the paint can.
PPG paints. Chip and other people are calling it the paint can, but hey, that's what it is. They split off their glass business and they're into the PPG paints, so they're the sponsors there, and that's where it's at.
But, you know, the Penguins, they pretty much have cemented the, Matt Murray as their number one goaltender.
Yeah, he's
Marc-Andre Fleury is not a bad option. Really hasn't had the best of marches. He's got roughed up a little bit, but still a quality backup. Both those goaltenders are going to need. I think this may end up being a little bit of an advantage for the Penguins as we get into the playoffs. Now, here's the part that concerns me about the Penguins. Got a team like Columbus that can play a very physical type of game.
Oh, yeah.
And last year, the Penguins game was speed and skills.
Sure.
And, when people tried to play physical with them, like Washington did last year, the Penguins were able to overcome that. Now, you know, with so many players injured and coming back off the injured list, what is that going to do for the Penguins, and what happens
and
if they run into, Columbus has one goaltender who's probably a Vezina Trophy candidate.
Yeah.
The Vezina Trophy goes to the best goaltender in the league. And, you know, a team can ride a horse like that deep into the playoffs. With Chris Letang still out, I think the one player that the Penguins can't afford to have on the injured list going into the playoffs is Chris Letang. He is so critical to their defense, and he's the captain of their power play.
Just the speed and how he can bring up a puck overcomes a lot of the deficiencies that are out there.
So, we've got 3 games left. I really don't think, these guys that are injured really need any ice time before we get into the playoffs. I think it's going to be in their best interest to get as many people healthy as they can because,
They may even be holding a few of them back because the way the reports are on who's got the lower body injury, who's got the upper body injury.
Well, Bosma was coach, you never knew what was injured. Now, at least Sullivan tells you that it's either,
lower
above the waist or below the waist, but no idea what the injury is.
Right.
And
I'm skeptical on when they do that, because they're supposed to be honest about it. But look at the NFL.
They do that for Vegas's sake.
There's gambling.
The NFL doesn't want to have anything to do with gambling because it speaks to the integrity of the game. But so the Penguins are going to have their work cut out for them going into the first round of the playoffs because it looks like Columbus. There is an outside chance that if Washington would lose all of their games, the Penguins won all of theirs, they could end up in first place for the division. But at what price?
Yeah.
At what price? Because they would have to beat Columbus tonight in their next 3 games. And, do you Do you do that to get the number one seed and get home ice advantage throughout the playoffs? And, you know, that's, to me, that's like winning the battle and losing the war. You know, so right. I think what they really need to do is get in there and
win this game.
Yeah, you know, win tonight's game, but then, you know, they still need to, you know, they would need to win tonight's game, and they'd have to win at least another game
sure.
to put them up 5 points with two games left. Then Columbus would have no chance, and they could rest everybody.
Sure.
They could bring up the entire Wilkes-Barre team and skate them for
which
two
is
games.
A good team.
Yeah, yeah.
They're a good team down there. Don't yeah. belittle that.
Well, you know, I mean, the Penguins wouldn't be where they're at today if it wasn't for all the kids they brought up from Wilkes-Barre.
It's amazing that they bring these players to plug in, and they end up staying for a few games, and then he throws them back down, brings another guy up to replace that guy.
Well, you know,
he's a master at it.
And here's the question that's been asked all year. And especially as we get closer to the end of the season, you have Connor McDavid, who is the up-and-coming superstar or the next great thing.
Yeah.
In Edmonton, who finally got them back to the playoffs for the first time in more than a decade.
Yeah.
And then you've got Sid Crosby. And if you look at Sid Crosby, he's probably had one of his best years of his career this year. But if you look at how many different people he skated with this year, I mean, I think it just speaks to how good of a player he is, because he hasn't had the same line mates consistently all season long.
And staying healthy like he has, you know, not being concussed and damaged like that, I think he's healed up from that. He's shown the burst of speed, the changes he can make. And he's leading the league in goals.
Yeah, and the ability to put the puck in the net.
Look, he just put one off the goaltender's head.
But, you know, you've got Evgeny Malkin, who still isn't back yet, and I guess they must be getting him ready.
I think they're just prepping him.
You know, you need Malkin, you need Letang, and you know, I mean, Murray has the ability to get hot. It'll be interesting.
Goaltender.
I'll tell you what, I will say this, and this is no knock on the Penguins or Mike Sullivan, but I think they're going to have an uphill battle defending that cup this year. Certainly, everybody's gunning for them.
Yeah,
you're going to get and when you play in a 7-game series, it's nothing like when you're playing in a regular season. In a regular season, you know, you're playing one game and then you're playing another team in a different style the next night. You're going to be playing the same team, and you know they're going to develop
things. Well, the mentality part, like you're saying, every team gets up for the Penguins. They're the champs, mm-hmm. So guess what? They want to knock them down. And the Pens have been able to come back from 3-goal deficits and more, anybody else with Sullivan. It's amazing.
If you notice what happens, though, in playoff hockey, you see a lot of 2-1, 3-2 games. You don't see a lot of high-scoring games.
You don't see that 5-goal, 6-goal.
And that's the thing, because they tighten everything up. And if you also notice that you didn't see this much, but last year in our playoff run, guys were giving up their bodies and blocking shots like nothing sure. I have ever seen. And that's probably part of one of the biggest reasons why they won last year. And that's what you're going to see in the playoffs.
Look at Bonino and the blocks that he does.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he even blocked one with his hand the other game, which
is
crazy.
And that leads to injuries. But what I was going to say before was, you know, in all professional sports, you know, they say that winning the Stanley Cup is the most grueling journey to win a championship
sure.
of any of the major sports. You know, you've got the NBA, who has you have to win 4 series, but with the
NHL,
it's a lot different because there's a lot more contact, and
it's a tough sport. You got to give them credit. Hey, they're trying to get back-to-back. It's rare. They've done it before, 92-93, so I'm still saying we can do it. It's going to be a definite uphill battle.
No question.
You know, they got the talent. They got the skills. They got the mindset to come back from adversity. They've done that. They got a goaltender that can come in. Fleury can come in. If Murray gives up 4 goals, Fleury can come in and hold him. He's done it.
Yep. No, it
so, I mean, we have that potential. They've proven it throughout the season, which is rare mm-hmm. to be able to do it, to be in this position. So Sullivan's a heck of a coach. I got to give him credit. He gets out there and criticizes the guys. And
Penguins up 1-0, end of the first period.
There we go. There we go. We got one in early.
Got a score first, but you know, got a lot of hockey left to play down there at the paint can. So we'll keep you in
we'll tune. Be here another 14 minutes. Right. Then you can change over to Root, watch the Penguins, and we're going to go to a little bit of Bucko talk. That's one of Chip's favorites, in case you haven't watched the show.
You know, one of the things that I found interesting, you know, it seems to me that more people have just absolutely lived to criticize the Pirates and spend less time supporting them. Now, I know that this Pirate, that they have a deep, strong fan base. You know, I'm a season ticket holder myself, and I'm very optimistic this year. But, you know, I am that way every spring and ever since.
Las Vegas has it like 85 either under or over. What are you leaning in there?
I'm leaning as the Penguins are going to win 90 games. I think the Pirates are capable.
They'll be coming back like they were 2 years ago.
Of winning 90 games this year. And, you know, I mean, you know, were they as good as the 98-win team from 2015? Were they as bad as the team that won 78 last year? I think they're going to be somewhere in the middle, and I don't think I'm going to split it down the middle. I think what's going to happen is the young pitchers that we've got are going to develop, because I think the seasoning they got last year, and I think, you know, we took a step back last year simply because we weren't going to overpay for a bunch of pitchers. We tried an experiment with some older arms.
Didn't work out.
If we could rekindle the magic, and it didn't work. But you know what? We washed our hands of that. We brought up a bunch of young guys.
And then Liriano failed.
And Liriano looked good when he pitched against us in Montreal this past weekend. But, you know, we'll see what he's got. But, okay, so we've got a bunch of young arms. And Gerrit Cole is coming off of a down year. Let's not forget in 2015. He was one of the four top pitchers in the National League. Now, yesterday, you know, he pitched 4 2/3 innings of great ball.
95 to 99 miles an
hour. He was hitting 99 on the gun. And you know what? A number of things led to his bad inning. You know,
triple.
You know, pitch selection may have been one. A triple that should have only been a double. You know, there was a ball that was misplayed by Jordy Mercer.
Deep in the hole.
In the hole, but the runner was not one of the most fleet of foot. No. But you know, if he would have taken the time to set himself and throw it, you know, could have been a different outcome. So you know, they tried the shift, and I love when people do that with the shift. You want to see them stop doing the shift. Hit the ball where they don't have anybody at. I scream it all the time at the ballpark. So, you know, yesterday was, you know.
One bad inning. Here's how I look at it, Chip. One bad inning. We know how Cole gets down on himself because he's emotional. He wears his emotions on his sleeve, and it's just natural, and it just beat him down a little bit. Mm-hmm. He was trying a little extra.
But the thing that I liked, okay, is that, you know, this Pirate team didn't give up. They fought back. They got three runs. They were in a position in the seventh inning to tie.
Yeah.
And McCutchen chased a bad pitch.
Right.
You know, maybe he's trying to do too much because, you know,
he was 0 for 4.
The critics are there. So, you know, here's the one thing, you know, while we're on the Pirates, and I just think the most redundant argument that I hear from people, and I get a little bit smart with them when they say this, is they don't spend enough money to win. And here's my question for everybody that wants to beat this dead drum, okay? Please, somebody tell me, what is the exact dollar amount the Pirates have to spend to become a championship team? Now, somebody can give me and guarantee me that if they spend X number of dollars, we're going to have a championship. It doesn't work that way, okay? Chicago last year, everything fell into place for them. Are they going to repeat this year? I don't think so, you know? I don't think
we'll see what happens. They might be 0-2 after tonight's game with the Cardinals. Mm-hmm. So they lost the first one. So yeah. That can happen.
But
you go through streaks in baseball.
Last year, we started out the year 3-0. The Cardinals started out the season 0-3. okay? Right. But it, as it ended up at the end of the year, neither of them made the playoffs, okay? So, you know, it's going to be a long season. We're going to see some players mature. Got Adam Frazier, who's really showing that, man.
He's 400. It's unbelievable.
He's a good ball player. And as a utility man, the super utility guy, he could play second. He could play third.
Left field.
He could play left field.
Left field, he played the ball off the Green Monster. One bounce held a guy to a single. Mm-hmm. Ran over, and the foul line's very short.
Yes.
And he reached into the crowd and grabbed the ball there and held him from some runs. So he's got some talent. He wasn't known for his fielding. He's known for his hitting. He's always hit.
And, you know, this is the one thing, and I don't get this, but so many people have so much hatred for Bob Nutting, and I can't for the life of me understand why. He brought in good quality baseball people to run his baseball operation, and he's letting them run the operation. Okay, so their business model is they're going to work on a budget, okay? And I can accept that if that's the way they're going to run things. But if it wasn't for Bob Nutting, PNC Park would be an empty stadium. There would not be a team here in Pittsburgh. The reason why the Pirates are still here and we get to enjoy them 81 times during the summer is because of the efforts of Bob Nutting. He turned the franchise into a moneymaker again. And so what? He makes money. Hey, any businessman out there that isn't making money isn't in business for very long. So I applaud him.
You got people that are jealous, envious of somebody making $20 million, $30 million. I mean, they have an investment here. I drank the Kool-Aid 4 years ago. It was good grape Kool-Aid. So I believe that their five-year plan, it took 7 years. Hey,
you know,
I'm patient. It took 20 years to break that streak.
You know, and let's remember, you know, the Pirates of the 70s, probably one of the most successful decades of the franchise. We won a World Series in 71. We won one in 79. Yeah. But you know what? We didn't win the division every year. We had good quality teams.
You want is a team that can compete. You want pitchers that can throw the ball and do well with it. And maybe they get a bad break.
Maybe they
get a good break.
2006, 07, 08, 09, 2010. I went to a lot of ball games. And you know what? I went and saw one major league team playing the AAA team that the Pirates put on the field. And all I ever asked...
Or worse than AAA.
And all I ever asked was, if the Pirates could put a major league baseball team that is competitive on the field, that's what I want to see. And every time I go down to PNC Park, I watch two major league teams play. And yes, do I agree with every decision Clint Hurdle makes? No. But you know what? He's the manager of the team. He knows more about those players than I do. And he's had a lot more success than he's had failures. So, you know what? The Pirates are giving you everything that you have asked for. And as a season ticket holder, I get my money's worth every time I go to the ballpark. So I don't understand what people complain about. So,
like I said, they have some jealousy and anger issues that are their own problem when you go through it. And you think about it. You got a lot of these stations that like stirring up stuff, you know, the fan, etc. They want to stir it up because they don't want happy people doing it. But most of the fans that are Pirate fans and traditional, like I'm a traditional Pirate fan my whole life, and I support them. I just question some things at some times.
You know, I support
because
them.
It's like a family.
I supported them in the good times. I support them in the bad times. I support them in the in between times. You know, they're my buckos. I mean, this is a team that I fell in love with as a child, and that love affair has been going on for 57 years. So
And you enjoy it. So that's what counts. And do you get frustrated when they lose or make a couple mistakes or errors?
Sure. But the game of baseball, you know, the thing most people don't realize is in baseball, you usually fail more often than you succeed.
We taught Smokin' Jim, or at least I did.
A 300
seven
hitter,
out of 10 times.
A 300 hitter is a superstar, but he fails 7 times out of 10. You know, so.
And it's unheard of in other sports to be a failure that often.
Right.
Even Ted Williams, the last of the 400 hitters, 6 out of 10, he didn't hit the ball.
Well, Ted Williams also said, and he is probably one of the greatest hitters in baseball history.
Oh, well, if he didn't serve in three different wars.
Yeah, he fought in Korea and he fought in World War II. But he said the single hardest feat in all professional sports is hitting a round ball with a round bat and hitting it squarely that's being thrown 90 plus miles an hour.
And he was pretty good at it.
Yeah. Well, he used to tell people, like, well, you know, what was his key to hitting? He says, I hit between the stitches. Those guys can't even see the stitches.
Exactly. You know,
his eyesight was uncanny. So.
Yeah, and he worked at it, too. He was one that did work at it.
Something else I wanted to touch on, and even though my dear friend Jim Frazier's not here this week.
He didn't make it. We're down to the last 3 minutes.
Our NFL scout extraordinaire, and I know we're going to have some draft talk coming up.
Oh,
but
yeah.
The Steelers are inviting a quarterback to work out that is being considered either a first or a second round draft pick.
Whoa.
So, you know, I mean, so our first drafted pick is at number 30. Our second one is at 62. We've got 2 third round draft picks. So what are the Steelers going to do? Are they going to go for a quarterback that high? Because from what I understand, and Jim, I would defer to Jim if he was here, that the draft next year is going to be extremely weak at the quarterback position.
Sure.
And, you know, Ben, talking retirement, may force them to start looking for, you know, hey, yeah. You know, who better to be a tutor to his replacement than Ben Roethlisberger to a new one. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. You know, Steelers
they're $22 million under the cap. I'm excited about that.
The Steelers need running back. As you know, Le'Veon Bell hasn't made it through a season yet.
He hasn't been healthy for a whole year.
Hasn't made it through a season yet. You know, we need outside linebacking. We need a cornerback.
Yes.
Sure.
These are traditional.
Yeah, you know, so, I mean, there's a lot of...
And who's coming back? Martavius Bryant?
Well, if he ever gets reinstated,
NFL's looking into
They're not being real quick on, you know, but, I mean, hey, you fail 6 tests, I can understand why you'd be a little bit skeptical.
Sure, it makes sense. Well, we're down to the last couple minutes. I want to thank everybody for watching our show. Sorry Smoke and Jim didn't make it. He has a lot of fans. Ran into a friend of mine today, and he said he just loves Smoking Jim and what he brings to the table, and he's laughing and stirring stuff up. Well, he'll be back next week. Hopefully he leaves on time and doesn't have a traffic and can find his way across the Liberty Bridge here. So we'll see that. Chip, it's been a pleasure with you here talking the whole time. We covered a lot of subjects there.
A lot of sports going on. Hey, I get down to the ballpark for my first game on Saturday night. Braves are in town. I'm excited. I just wish, for my wife's sake, the low is supposed to be 32 on Saturday, but the high in the high 30s.
Yeah.
Last year, the first game we went down, I went down for the opener because it was on Sunday last year. And I think in the sun, it was okay, but I mean, I'll be down there with the Under Armour and the Long Johns. And,
hey, that's why you got those.
And
clothes.
The hand warmers and the foot warmers, but that's not baseball weather, but I'll
And they
I'll
have hot chocolates. Drink the hot chocolate.
Yeah, that turns into cold chocolate almost immediately.
Well, they got to work on some of that stuff, but I'm sure you'll have fun. It's nice to be talking Buccos. Mm-hmm. I always enjoy the Buccos. Of course, we got Steeler talk coming up with drafts. Penguins are playing, so... Go Pens. It's 1-0. Penguins are winning. Hope Casey's enjoying the game. Hope Devin Shea enjoys the game. We had a fun time talking to you and sharing our insights. And we'll be back next week. And just want to thank Dave Cable for letting us put on this show. And I want to end the show with Stay Joey Strong.